can encourage, can motivate, can speak life into someone else's group, and can see lives change with their very eyes. If you want to see your life change, join the group.
Jesus. In other words, it's important to always be taking a step towards Jesus. And here at Hope Church, we have a class just for that, and it's called Next Steps. In Next Steps, we get the opportunity to sit around tables, we drink coffee, we eat snacks, and we talk about what it means to follow, grow, and live for Jesus. And I would love for you to join us in the classroom. So right
Hope Church, how are we doing? Has it been feeling good? A good Sunday? Well, I am super excited to be with you. My name is Joshua. For those of you that have not met me, I'm just glad you're here. This is an exciting time. We're about to jump into some worship. We're going to hear some incredible teaching. So go ahead and stand up. For those of you who might be new here, we like to get to know each other. We like to be a family together. So if you are new here and you're going, I don't know anything about Hope Church, that's okay. You're not supposed to know everything before you come. We have an awesome spot out there with some first-time guests that would love to get you connected and plugged in. But one of the ways that we do that is we like to get to know each other. So I want you to turn around to someone, maybe someone you don't know, and learn their name. Learning names is so important because that's how you feel welcome. We want to make sure you're welcomed. And then we're going to get ready for some worship.
He won't fail. He won't fail. Sing that out. He won't fail. He won't fail. Come on, one more time. He won't fail. He's faithful. Let's give him praise this morning. Come on.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I is all I know. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken.
Come on.
It's my fear. It doesn't save the chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand the chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand the chance when I a place to hide, as I am not a captive to the lies. When I'm not afraid to leave my past behind, oh, I won't be shaken.
Come on.
No, I won't be shaken. It's my fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I
us, that he's taking care of us. Amen. All right, let's sing this new song together. Come on. Hey. faith. There's still one thing that I know. There's no way, no way you're gonna let me down. You never have, never will, and you won't start now. There's no way, no way your promise can fail. You never has, never once, and you never will. Amen. Come on.
There's no way that I'm back now, just because I'm still waiting. And this is where I'm going to praise.
Come on, church.
Jericho walls are coming down. Even now I feel them shaking, and I refuse to be afraid. Yes, I refuse to be afraid. 'Cause there's no way, no way you're gonna let me down. You never have, never will, and you won't start now.
An amazing God, a God who loves us and has been there through the thick and the thin of our life. He's with us no matter what. And I know that you might be going through some difficult seasons. There are hard things that we face in life. There are a lot of challenges that we have to go through. But God is with you in the midst of the good times and the bad times. The Holy Spirit is with you to help bring you through those seasons, to help shape you and grow you and help you become a better person than you ever thought you could be. This past week, I was reading in the book of Romans 12. This is verse 11 and 12, and it says, "Do not lack diligence and zeal. Be fervent in the Spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. be patient in affliction, and be persistent in prayer. Guys, our faith is not meant to be a consumerist faith. It's meant to be an active faith, one that we're every single day we are waking up and living out the goodness of God in our life, reaching out to others, bringing hope to people who feel hopeless. That is the God that we serve. We serve a God of action, a God who wants us to act in love and reach out to others. That's why we do what we do here at Hope Church. That's why everything that has been happening this morning is from volunteers who make things happen, who work in action. That's why we want you to get connected. We want you to go to Next Steps so that you can know more about us. That's why we ask for you to serve and to jump in and to reach out to the people around you and play an active role in their faith journey. It's why we ask that you give. And we ask that you help us accomplish the mission through your finances. That's an important and key in the powerful ministry that we do here. That's why we do what we do, to help you follow, grow, and live for Jesus. Be active in your faith. As we transition now into a time of teaching, I just want to pray for us and pray for this morning, because God is going to do an amazing work. God, we thank you for this morning. I thank you for just every single aspect of our church. God, I thank you for every single person in this room, online, watching during the week. God, I pray that you would speak to them in this time of teaching. God, that your Holy Spirit would just fill their life, help them live a new, changed, different version than they ever thought they could live. God, we pray for this morning. We pray over Pastor Tad's message, that you would use his words to inspire us and to light a fire within our souls. God, I thank you so much for this morning. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. You guys can be seated. How are we doing this morning? Hope Church, we doing well? Come on, how are we doing today? We doing good? Excited for you to be with us today. So excited for what God has in store. Already just an amazing morning set before us. And so if you are new to Hope Church, whether you're in person or online today, we are just so honored to have you with us. Thank you for spending your morning with us here at Hope Church. I do want to tell you right out of the gate just a few really awesome things we have going on around Hope Church over the next few weeks, beginning with April the 28th, which is going to be Baptism Sunday. And so if baptism is your next step, yeah, we can get excited about that. We love baptisms here at Hope Church. If baptism is your next step in your relationship with Jesus, your next opportunity is April the 28th. And so we do believe here at Hope Church that baptism is not what saves you. It's you telling the world that you belong to Jesus. And it is our first act of obedience in our relationship with Jesus. And so maybe you were like me, you grew up a church kid. And maybe if you grew up as a Baptist church kid, you got baptized every time you went to camp or every time you made a decision. But maybe as a young 20-something or as an adult, you really made the decision to follow Jesus, and now you're ready to tell the world, man, I belong to him. Baptism is that opportunity. It's a huge celebration. We already got a good number of people going to be part of that day. We would love for you to scan that QR code, come hang out with us that morning, throw a celebration with us, whether you're in person, online, no matter where you're at in the world, you can drive and be with us. We would love to be part of that day with you. Huge celebration. I do want to let you know our next big event happening here at Hope Church is Mother's Day at Hope Church, which is hard to believe is Sunday, May 12th, just right around the corner. Really big day here at Hope Church. We're going to have a really awesome picture spot for moms that we have every year. We're also going to have a free gift for all the moms in attendance that day. We're also going to have a ministry with us called Hope Out Loud Ministries. They were with us back in 2018, and so some of you may not have been here to be part of that, but let me just tell you this. If you've ever gone through a trial or a difficulty or suffering and wondered, where is God in the midst of all of this? This is the day you're not going to miss. In fact, they wrote a book many years ago called Beauty Out of Ashes. They're going to tell you how God can take tragic moments and use them for his good. And what you begin to hear about is the way that God's using them and their story all over the world, literally. A very tragic, difficult situation, but how God has used it. That's how God works, right? God takes our worst moments, our tragedies, our difficulties, and he still uses all things for his good. We talked a little bit about that last week as we kicked off this teaching series. And so I want to encourage you to go ahead and make plans to be with us on Sunday, May the 12th. All right, let me tell you about something really cool we have going on here at Hope Church. As kind of the mission of our church, we have long said that we want to be a church that is generous in every single way possible. What I love about our church is that we are an incredibly generous church. 10 years ago, we merged two churches together, and we formed this church called Hope Church. We made a commitment to God. We said, God, we will be obedient to you, and we will be generous on every occasion. In the past 10 years, we are rapidly approaching $1 million that we've been able to give away locally, nationally, and internationally through the generosity of Hope Church. And so that's all of us. I just want to say thank you for your giving, for your generosity, because we get to make a difference in the lives of so many people. And so if you've been part of our church for a while, then you know that really is our heartbeat. We are always looking, as the Bible says, we have a generous eye, looking for ways in which we can be generous. So I want to tell you about something really cool that's going on, but I want to give you a little bit of backstory for just a moment to kind of tell you why we are where we are today. So back in 2008, 2009, the church that I started here in 2006 was renovating a shopping center out in Hall River. We had an entire shopping center out there. If you're familiar with was 70 and where it kind of splits right there, that was our shopping center. We were renovating that. And I have some pastor friends like other people. I got people in my life who are my friends who call in and check on me. And one day we were in the middle of this renovation. We were brand new. We were just 2 years old. We had spent everything we had. And my good friend, Pastor Jonathan Robbins, who pastors the Summit Church out in Kernersville, North Carolina, he called me and he just asked me how the project was going. And so we were just kind of talking through the time together, kind of talking about what was going on. He's asking what needs we had. And I'm just talking, so I don't know what his agenda is. I don't know what his goal is. And I said, man, listen, if we have service tomorrow, we don't have any chairs. We have no money for seats. He said, well, what are you going to do? I said, bro, I don't really know. He said, well, how many chairs would you like to have? And I said, man, we would love to start with 500 chairs in this building. And we just kept talking, and he never said anything. About 20 minutes later, he called me back, and he said, hey, I'm sending you a link. I want you to go online, pick out the chairs. We'll have them delivered to you next week. And so that church gifted us with about $25,000 gift and purchased brand new 500 chairs for our church. Listen, that moment marked me. And I said, God, if there would ever be an opportunity that we could repay that favor, God, we're going to look for that opportunity. As you've been with us, you know that we've helped get churches get started. We've helped fund churches. We've helped give them sound systems and sound equipment. We've helped start churches up in Boston and places all over the world. And we've been looking for that opportunity, for an opportunity to pay forward. So you guys, let's just fast forward to film for just a moment. Back in February, if you were with us, Pastor Adam Bellamy was here. Y'all remember Pastor Adam Bellamy? Pastor Thrive Church here in Burlington, good friend of mine. I have a great relationship with Pastor Adam. We have one where we challenge one another. I was meeting with him a few months back, and I was challenging him on his church. His church is kind of in a place where they've been in a very small building for a really long time, and it's kind of limited their capacity to be able to grow beyond that. And I really began to challenge him to trust God. I said, hey, man, this facility really is your shoe, and really you can't see what God wants to do and desires to do until you give him an opportunity to expand that capacity to grow. So I started challenging him to get out of his facility, and that was something that he was very nervous about, but we started talking about it, praying through it. So he preached here on Sunday in February, right? And the next morning, I'm in staff meeting, and I get 3 phone calls from Adam in a row. Bam, I don't answer it. Bam, I don't answer it. I don't answer it. I'm like, something must be going on. So I run out of our staff meeting, and I call him like, hey, Adam, is everything okay? He said, hey, Tad, I just need your help with something. I need you to pray with me about something. I said, what's going on? He said, about 10 years ago, I preached at a church here in Burlington. He said, and that church gone through some hard times. They just called me this morning, and they're asking about coming under our umbrella and gifting us their facility. And so he said, I just need you to pray about it. And so we began to pray about it together and kind of walk through that journey together. Well, that transaction has happened. They've been gifted a building now that's about 4 times the space that they had in their previous facility. And it's an amazing moment. We're so proud of them. We're excited for them. And so I got to go over to the building a few weeks back and kind of pray over it with him, walk through it. We're kind of walking through. He's kind of casting some vision, kind of an older church, trying to do some renovations. And we got to the auditorium, and he said, man, I would really like to rip the pews out of this place. He said, but we can't afford chairs. And I just let him talk for a little bit. And I just let him talk for a little bit and talk for a little bit. And as he kind of got going, I could see just the anxiety in his face. And before we left there, I said, here's the deal, man. We got your chairs, bro. We're gonna buy you some chairs. We're gonna gift you with 250 chairs. But I want to just show you a little message that he sent over this past Friday. Check this out.
Good morning, Hope Church. What an honor it is to be a part of your service this morning. I just want to take a minute to share with you a little bit of what God is doing in the journey of Thrive Church. As you know, Pastor Tad and I are very connected. I love your pastor. He is amazing. We have long since outgrown our church, and for the last couple of years, our biggest prayer was, God, give us a new location, expand our borders. And God's answered that prayer in a way that is beyond anything we could ask, think, or believe. A local church in our area asked us to adopt them. They want to come under our Thrive umbrella and give us this space. But one of the challenges were, how do we transform this location into a new Thrive facility? So I asked Pastor Tad to come over, and we began to daydream through this facility. And one of my first questions was, I really want to put chairs in here, but I'm not real sure where to order them. And Pastor Tad, without hesitation, said, I've been praying. And my team, my church, and myself believe that God wants us to sew 250 chairs into this new location. And I just want to thank you. I want to say thank you so much, because it was a challenge. We weren't sure how the Lord was going to answer. But God miraculously used Hope Church to answer our prayer. Now, just in case you're wondering, the pews behind me will not go to waste. There's been a church in Mexico that's a recent plant that has been praying that God would send them pews. So we will be disassembling these pews, putting them in a trailer, and they'll be going to a church in Mexico. So I just want to let you know that you are answering prayers not only right here in Graham, North Carolina, but you're answering them in Mexico too. I cannot thank you enough for the lives that will be impacted, because you made room in the kingdom of God for them to hear the gospel. And I just want to thank Pastor Tad, his team, and Hope Church so much for this amazing gift. God bless you. Have an amazing service.
That's all. How cool is that, right? How cool is that? Because of the generosity of our church, we get to impact a church who also gets to impact a church in Mexico. Is that cool or what, man? Can we just give God a huge round of applause one more time? I love that. And so if you are part of the generosity here at church, I just want you to know we couldn't do it without you. We could not make it happen. And again, we're in a place where we're able to do that. And I long pray that we could be in that position, that we could be healthy enough as a church to just be able to respond to meet a need. And you guys are making that happen. And so thank you so very much. Let's jump right into our series today. If you're just joining us today, we began a 5-week teaching series last week on the book of James, entitled Faith Without Works is Dead. We talked last week about the issue of testing and perseverance. Because here's the reality is that we are going to be tested in life. And when you and I are tested in life, the question is, what does it do to our faith? When you walk through hardships, when you walk through trials and difficulties in life, what does it do to your faith? We talked last week about when you're pressed. When life comes pressing down on you and you're pressed, what comes out of you? What spills out of your life? From the very start of James chapter 1, James encourages us to rejoice during our trials. Why? Because we believe in faith God is building something on the other side. We believe in the middle of our trial, no matter how difficult it might be, that on the other side, in faith, God is still doing something that I may not be able to see right now, but I trust in faith that God is going to work his plan and his purpose through all of this. We saw last week that adversity is what causes us to go higher. Adversity and trials cause us to be greater. Adversity and trials call for us to trust deeper. Why? Because trials and testing are what ultimately God uses to build our faith. It's just how God works. We're going to pick up today, if you have a Bible with you today, we're going to pick up in James chapter 1 in the second half of the chapter today. We're going to be in verses 19 through 27. And so if you have a Bible with you today, whether you're in person, online today, go ahead and get there, earmark it. You can write some stuff down, open up the Bible on your phone, get out a notes tab. I want you to take some notes, write some things down today. Before we jump in, though, I want to remind you that James, who's the half-brother of Jesus, is also a pastor. He pastors the church in Jerusalem. He has a heart as a pastor. When you read the book of James, you can lose sight of that sometimes, because it's easy for it to kind of sound harsh and condescending a little bit. Because when James writes this letter, he drops the hammer on the church. But I want you to know he's writing this letter from a place of love and compassion for his people. Why does he have love and compassion for his people? Because he knows there's a debilitating disease that could easily set into the heart of a believer and the heart of the church. And this debilitating disease is called apathy. Becoming apathetic. He knows that as a follower of Jesus, the moment that apathy begins to set in, the moment you get indifferent to the things of God, the moment you come into church, and the longer you start to go through church, the easier it is to settle in, to sit back, and just say, you know what? I believe these things to be true, but no longer acting as if your faith is true. And so what you have is a pastor who's pushing on his people because he's saying, we don't have the luxury to sit around. We don't have the time to be lukewarm and apathetic in our faith. I would echo the sentiment of James today and say, Hope Church, we do not have time to sit around and be lukewarm and apathetic in our faith, just saying that you know what, I have a system of beliefs, but I don't have the faith to actually act on it. Y'all hear me right now? Y'all staying with me? Y'all tracking with me? He says, listen, I want you to be people today who are constantly moving in your faith, active in your faith. So let's jump into James chapter 1, verse 19 through 25. I'm going to read all of it up front to you today, and then we're going to unpack it together. He says this, Know this, my beloved brothers, that every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of a man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. Verse 22, but be doers of the word and not hearers, only deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away at once, forgets what he looks like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty or freedom, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his what? Blessed in his what? Doing. Blessed in his doing. James starts by saying, know this. It's a way in which he's saying, I need you to take note. You can say it this way, this is what you need to know. He says, if you want to grow in wisdom, you want to grow in maturity, you want to grow in your faith, then I'm about to drop some wisdom on you. This is what James is telling you. Go back to verse 19. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. We could just really go home after that message right there, couldn't we? Like, literally, that's a message in itself. It preaches itself, right? Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. He says, if you desire wisdom for your life, you want maturity in your relationship with Jesus, your walk with Jesus. You want to mature in your marriage. You want wisdom for marriage. You want wisdom for relationships or parenting your kids or finances or your career or education. You need to listen to God's truth and God's voice. You need to listen to what God's telling you. You know what he says? You don't gain wisdom from talking, AKA some of us talk way too much. Anybody know somebody like that? Anybody? I tell people it takes me like 15 minutes on Sunday mornings just to say good morning. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a man of a lot of words sometimes. Some of you are like, we know. We look at the clock every week. It gets longer. Kids, volunteers are down there like, we know, Tad. Let's go. Come on, let's go. Right? We get it, right? But what is he saying? James is saying, listen, you want to gain wisdom? You gain wisdom in life from listening, from hearing, not just talking. Remember, James is trying to build our faith. He's saying, when you need advice or guidance or wisdom, he asks this question, who are you consulting first? When you need wisdom in life, who are you going to first? Who are you listening to? As Jesus followers, we should first listen to God and respond to what God is leading us to do. We're quick to go to a book, a podcast, a TED Talk, social media, and he says that says a lot about your faith. Who do you go to first, and then how do you respond to what you've heard? A lot of times we go to God, but we don't stop long enough to actually hear him, let alone respond to what he's actually saying to us. I heard a long time ago that we have two ears and one mouth, so we should listen twice as much as we talk, right? We should listen twice as much as we speak. James gives us sort of an equation to live by. He says, be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. This is directly tied to our relationship with God and how we relate to God's people, to other people. We are a culture of people today who are quick to spout off, aren't we? We are. Social media just made it worse, right? We got a bunch of social media heroes, you know, kind of bold and courageous, you know, behind the keyboard. And it's like everything that happens just needs my opinion. Not everything needs your opinion. Now, let me just say that again. Not everything needs your opinion. But we believe that, right? Like I need to say something. I need to speak here. And then we kind of settle into this place where we say, you know what? I just can't help it. I'm a very opinionated person. If I think it, I say it. If I feel a certain way, I'm going to just express it. That's just who I am. And I'd say, yes, but that's not someone who is maturing. It's not. I've had to learn the hard way. Growing up, I was one of those kind of people who was like, I'll just tell you whatever, however I feel, whatever I want to say, I just say it. If I think something about you, I'll just rip you to shreds because that's just, I can't change who I am. And I'd say that was a sign of immaturity. In your own sinful nature, your own spirit, you're speaking as if somebody who says, I can never change, I'll always be this way. When you talk that way, you're not talking about a life of faith, trusting in the Holy Spirit. You're saying, I'll always be this person. I'll always act this way. And I'd say, in your spirit, you always will. But the Holy Spirit desires to change you, to mature you. Sometimes the best thing you and I can do, hold on, is shut up and listen. Not speak, just listen and say nothing. How many of us, let me ask you a question, in person, online today, how many, just a show of hands, how many of us have said things that we regret because we were quick to speak instead of being quick to listen? How many of us? How many of us have gotten ourselves, words leave, you can't bring them back in, right? And now the damage has already been done, and then you think, well, you know what, it's not my problem. You put me in that position. If you would have done what you had done, then I wouldn't have said what I said. And then we try to pawn it off, don't we? And so James is pushing on us. He's saying, if you really want to mature, you got to learn how to tame your tongue. He says that when you're quick to speak, it's often from a place of anger. And when people are angry, they don't represent the heart of God. The great German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, which is a mouthful, he said this. He says, just as our love for God begins with listening to God's word, the beginning of love for others is learning to listen to them. Just as our love for God begins with listening, what I have to hear God's word, I have to hear his truth. And then what I do, I respond to that. That's how you come to faith in Jesus. I have to hear God, I have to respond to him. He says, and then that's where we begin our love relationship. Me understanding what God has done and me responding to that. He says, in the same way, how do we learn to love other people? We listen to them. You know, I have a tendency sometimes to get angry at my kids. Anybody else? And I hold my kids to a standard that's ridiculous. Do you ever do this? I'm 43, about to turn 44 this summer, and I treat my kids like they should be 43-year-olds. Don't you ever do this? Why do you think that way? Why? I don't say it out loud, but you think, why are you so dumb? You ever feel this way? Like, why would you make that decision? And they're 10 and 12 and 14 and 15. You know what I mean? But in my mind, I'm thinking, why don't you have the wisdom? And a lot of times they'll react a certain way or they'll do a certain thing, but I don't take time to understand why they're reacting the way they're reacting or what they're actually going through. Because sometimes there's been moments when I've actually been successful in this and I ask how they're going and one of them break down and tell me about their day. And all of a sudden, you know what that does as a father? It makes me love them more and I want to help them more instead of just scream at them. Because the easiest thing to do is get angry and to scream. Often in our anger, James says, filthiness and wickedness comes out. When you get angry, what words come out of your mouth? When you're mad at your spouse or your kids or a boss or maybe you have the whole kind of hit your thumb with a nail or a hammer or whatever it might be, what comes out? Because the Bible says what comes out is really who you are. The things you say really is who you are, so things that you've ingested. He says anger is not attractive. Anger does not draw people closer to the heart of Jesus. If you are constantly an angry person, you need to mature. You're a toddler. This is what James is saying, who can't help themselves, who throws tantrums and fits, who can't control their emotions, right? You need to stop being led by your spirit and begin to be led by the Holy Spirit. You have to receive meekness. Meekness is not a weakness. Meekness is bridled strength. Years ago, we were walking through a summer series called Summer on the Mount, and we were walking through a teaching series on the Sermon on the Mount, and Pastor Alex was teaching about this principle of meekness. And he used it in the illustration of a horse and how horses are meek, but horses are very powerful beings. You wouldn't say that a horse doesn't possess strength, but a horse has been trained through a bridle to be meek. They've chosen to be submissive, and their power is bridled strength, isn't it? This is what the Bible's trying to lay out before us. The ability to hold your tongue is one of the greatest of strengths. As I preach out loud, I'm preaching to Tad Grandstaff today, okay? He says this in verse 26. If anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, he deceives his heart. This person's religion is worthless. That's a pretty intense statement, isn't it? He says, don't say you have faith if you talk bad about others. Don't say you have faith if you judge others or gossip about others and say vile things, or if always anger comes out and you don't represent the heart of Jesus, you talk down to people. You don't represent the heart of Jesus. James is pressing on us. He's saying your words matter. You can't just say, that's just who I am. No. You're creating the image of God. You now represent him. You're an ambassador of Christ. You represent Jesus in your home, in your work environment, and at the gym, and your interactions on the school campus. You represent Jesus everywhere that you are. So you can keep saying, this is who you already are, but your faith should say, this is who Jesus has made me, this is who I am, and this is how I act. Doesn't mean I won't always get it right, but when I get it wrong, I'm quick to make it right. Does it make sense? Now watch. James is going to kind of turn into one of the most kind of famous passages in Scripture, beginning in James chapter 1, verse 22. He says, but be doers of the word and not hearers only. He says, because if you're just someone who hears but doesn't do, you're deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away at once, forgets what he looks like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty or freedom, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. How many of us know there is a huge difference between listening and doing? Come on, how many of us know there's a big difference? If you've raised kids for 5 minutes, then you know there is a big difference between listening and doing. Let me just bring you into my house for just a moment and show you how this works, okay? So we can have dinner, and then everybody's kind of done, and they've kind of sometimes scattered, they're eating, and so it's time for us to clean the kitchen. And I'll say, everyone, bring your dishes into the kitchen. Me and Becky are trying to clean up. Me and Mom are trying to clean up. Hey, everybody, bring your dishes into the kitchen. Hey, and then I hear, we heard you. Hey, go ahead and bring them to the kitchen. We're trying to clean. We heard you. Hey, I need you to bring your dishes into the kitchen. I'll do it. I'll get to it. After I'm loading the dishwasher, I go in and it's still there. I say, hey, did you not hear what I said? I was going to get to it. I was going to do it. Dad, why are you always so angry? Like, you're not representing Jesus very well right now. Why are you getting so mad, Dad? Come on. And then I tell you, in those moments, I'm not quick to listen. I'm quick to speak, and I'm quick to get angry. You know what I'm saying? And my response is, why don't you get your lazy butt up off the freaking couch and do what I've asked you to do a million times? Why you got to ride me, Dad? Come on, man. And I'd say, hey, you want to be treated as a mature person? Then why don't you do what I've asked you to do without me asking you to do it? You know I'm going to ask you to do this every single time. So you want to be mature? You don't want me to ride you? Just get up and do what I've already asked you to do. And maturity says, I don't have to wait for Dad to beg or borrow or bargain with me to make it happen, right? Now, this is exactly what we understand in a principle when it comes to parenting teenagers or kids or even a husband or a spouse or whatever it might be, right? But this is exactly how so many of us approach God's word. We know there are things that God has called for us to do. We come to a place like this, we tune in online, we're in our quiet time, whatever it might be in our life, and we know there are some things that God has called for you and I to do. Some things you hear directly from the Lord that he says, I want you to start doing, stop doing, something you need to cut out of your life or surrender to me. And what do you say? I'll get to that. I'll do that. I heard you. I heard you, God. Okay, I'll do it. I'll do it. And we start to deceive ourselves as if hearing is the same as actually doing it. I'll make that change. I'll stop that. Hey, you know, I already kind of missed the new year, so man, 2025. Man, I'm gonna start that in 2025. I'm gonna stop doing that on Monday. I'm gonna get to there. I'm gonna do that in my life. I'm gonna, whatever it is, this is what we do. This is the game we play with God, isn't it? I was just journaling some stuff back about a month ago. I try to read ahead about a month ahead of what I'm kind of teaching through. And so I was going through the book of James about a month ago. And I just wrote down this statement. You can write this down if you want to. But the distance between listening and doing is called what? It's called what? It's called obedience. The distance between listening, hearing, and doing and responding is a word called obedience. If God is speaking to you or God has spoken to you and you have heard God speak to you, he has nudged on your heart, he has pushed you to some action, and you said, God, I'll get to it, you are being disobedient to God. Because God is your father who loves and cares about you. It's something that he's pushing you towards, and you just say, I'll get to it at some point. We're being disobedient to God. You might say, well, Tad, you know what, I'm doing some things. And say, I say, yeah, you are. And I don't believe that God will ever diminish our efforts in our journey in our relationship with Jesus. But many times we're just doing some things, but we're not doing the exact thing that God has called for us to do. It's like, I'm doing the one thing, and God's like, but I gave you a new thing. Again, coming to my house, for the last 15 years, at bedtime we've said, go upstairs, get your pajamas on, brush your teeth, get in bed. Anybody else feel me right now? Go upstairs, put your pajamas on, brush your teeth, get in bed. How many nights do you think 4 out of 4 take place? Do you think anybody in 15 years has done all 4 on their own? I go upstairs and I'm like, hey, what's going on? Where are we at? And somebody will say, I brushed my teeth. And I'm like, yeah, but you're still in your regular clothes. You still haven't put your pajamas on. You still haven't got bed. But I brushed my teeth. Hey, I've done 1 out of 4. I've done 2 out of 4. I've done 3 out of 4. You should be proud of me. I say, you know what? I'd be proud of you if you were a toddler and I was just teaching you. But after 10, 12, 14, and 15 years, I'm not very proud that I've asked you the same thing over and over and over and over, and you're only doing half of what I've asked you to do. You know what I discovered in life? Is that partial obedience is disobedience. And we love that with kids. We just don't love that when it comes to ourselves. God, I know you've called me for do X, Y, and Z, but I'm just gonna do X for the next 10 years. And I'm gonna convince myself, I'm gonna deceive myself that just doing X is enough. And again, I want you to understand, James is not calling us to a works-based faith. He's not saying that if you want faith, you have to do all these things, but he is saying if you have faith, you will do these things. Does it make sense? I'm not doing these things to earn God's love or approval or to earn my way into God's grace. I do these things because of God's grace, because I believe in faith that God has the very best for me. And God's trying to bring me to the very best he has for me. See, there's a huge difference between not knowing what to do and then knowing what to do and still choosing not to do it. One is called ignorance, and the other is called disobedience. See, God isn't holding you accountable if you're not doing something for lack of knowledge or knowing. But here's the truth. We are accountable for the truth that we know and we choose not to act on. James continues by saying that hearing and believing, that's the starting point of faith, but true faith is doing the things that God has asked for you to do. Jesus gives us an example of this one time in Matthew chapter 21, verse 28 through 32. He's talking to a group of religious people. He says, what do you think? He tells a story. A man has 2 sons. And he went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. And he answered, I will not. Sounds like one of my kids. I will not do it. But afterward, he changed his mind and he went. Took him a minute. He thought about it. He went and he did the right thing. And he went to the other son and said to him the same thing. And he answered, I go, sir, but did not go. That I'll do it, but didn't actually do it. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, the first. And Jesus said to him, truly I say to you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go into the kingdom of God before you, which would have been one of the most offensive statements you could have ever made to a group of religious people. The most hated sinners on the face of the planet were the tax collectors and the prostitutes, right? And he says, those people are getting into God's kingdom ahead of you. For John came, his cousin John the Baptist, came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed in what he said. And even when you saw, you did not afterward change your minds and believe him. You did nothing with what you heard. You heard, but you didn't act on it. In this passage, James makes, again, a very powerful statement about listening and doing. Again, he says the tax collectors and prostitutes will enter the kingdom ahead of the chief priests and Pharisees because they listened and responded to the message. They did not deceive themselves by simply hearing the message alone. Let me tell you how this breaks down in church today. We come to church and we say, man, that was a good sermon today. It doesn't matter who's preaching, me, whoever it is, it doesn't matter. Man, that was such a good sermon today. Man, I feel such conviction today. Man, I had my toes stepped on today, man. Man, I came face to face with some stuff. Man, God rocked my world today. I felt the need to repent. I felt the need to confess. I felt the need to change. What are you gonna do about it? Nothing. It just feels really good to come to a place to have a sermon that just kind of smacks me in the face. I just love that feeling. Isn't it kind of crazy how we just love the feeling of conviction? It makes us feel spiritual, doesn't it? So we feel this conviction, and there's a reason why, because the Holy Spirit is convicting us to bring change about us, and we kind of leave on the high of conviction. Man, that was so good. And what do? We deceive ourselves. And believing that just hearing and listening is the same as doing it, right? In faith, we say, I believe what they're teaching today, that to be truth. And James says, well, if you believe in faith, then it should move you to action. What are you doing with what you heard? What are you doing with what you're learning? The goal in following Jesus and his word being open and the Holy Spirit speaking to us is that you and I would be pruned. We would be stripped. We would be molded into the image of Jesus. Let me ask you a question that I've been asking myself all week long. Does listening even matter if there's no response? Does listening even matter? There's no response. You know, sometimes Becky will be talking to me and I'm listening, but I ain't really listening. You know what I'm saying? Anybody else listening right now? I'm kind of listening, but she kind of called me at a moment where maybe I was a little preoccupied. I was already working on something or whatever it might be or whatever excuse I can make, let's be honest. And I'm kind of listening, but I'm kind of not, because when I get done, she'll kind of stand there. And you ever have that gap of distance between you realize that she stopped talking for a little bit of time and she's just kind of staring at you? You know what she's waiting for? A response, isn't she? And then you're like, I don't know what to say right now because I wasn't quite listening. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about right now? Like, yes. Just say yes, right? When you don't know what else to do, just be like, yes, I agree with you. Yes and amen, right? Like, yes. You ever been in that moment before? Why? Because listening demands a response. If you heard me, respond. If you've heard the voice of God, what's your response? How will you respond? How you respond? See, we get so twisted in church, we kind of dumbed down faith to just a system of beliefs. We said this. I believe. And I say, yeah, that's the beginning point. Can't have a relationship with Jesus without starting to believe. But you know what James chapter 2 is going to tell us? James chapter 2 tells us that Satan and his demons believe in Jesus. They have faith. They've seen it. They had a firsthand witness account of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. They've seen it, but you know what? They never acted on that faith and surrendered their life over to Jesus. They're not walking forward in faith, and so belief is one aspect. And so James is saying, you gotta graduate beyond just believing. If you believe in something, it will move you to action. If you believe in your marriage, there will be action to back it up. You believe in your kids, there will be action to back it up. He says, what you believe in demands action out of our life. Jesus would put a whole nother illustration at a whole different point in his life. He's teaching the most important sermon we talked about just a bit ago, the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 through Matthew chapter 7. He closes out Matthew chapter 7 with these words right here. He says this in verse 24 to 27. He says, "Everyone who then hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man. He who hears and does is a wise man, who built his house on the rock, who built his house on Jesus, who built a foundation on Jesus. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on the house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. Its foundation was built on Jesus and his truth. His faith was on Jesus and there was action because something was built on it." Verse 26, "And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." The person who hears and does not act, foolish. The person who hears and does, wise. Go back to last week. Jesus says that the winds and the rains, that's the testing of life, the difficulties. And when you and I don't build our life on a solid foundation in Jesus, when we're not actively building on top of the truth of Jesus and the life he's called for us to live, then when the trials come and the storms beat against us, our faith will fail because our faith will not be rooted and centered on the things of Jesus. Go back to James again, verse 22 through 25. He says, "But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves." Don't deceive yourselves that just coming to church and hearing, tuning in, listen to a podcast, that hearing is all you need to do. He says, don't deceive yourself. Don't fall victim to just being a church attender who comes and just consumes great content from different pastors all over the country. And you just say, "Hey man, I'm listening to all this great stuff. That's awesome." Just know this, the more you listen to, the more you're accountable to. The more truth you know, the more accountable you are to actually act on that truth. It pays to be ignorant sometimes, I'm just saying, but anyway. "For anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in the mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and once forgets what he looks like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing." James says that hearing and seeing are not the same as doing. He says it's like looking in the mirror, seeing what needs to be fixed, and just going about your day as if it will fix itself or as if it doesn't matter to begin with. Imagine if I walked up to you today and I said, "Hey, I got some toothpaste right there." "Yeah, I know. I saw it this morning." you gonna deal with it? Nah. "Hey, you got a little bat in the cave right there?" You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just, "I love you. I want to help you." "Yeah, I saw it this morning. Well, I mean, like, now's a good opportunity to just go deal with that. No, it's cool. It feels good that it's just been seen. It feels really good that somebody told me to do something about it." "Well, what you gonna do something about it?" "No, I don't have any intention to do anything about it. It'll just fix itself." It'll fix itself. You say, that's insane. The whole point of the mirror is to expose to you what needs to be fixed, and then you act upon it. He says, when you gaze into God's word, this is the same truth. It exposes you. You come to a place like this and you feel exposed. How many times, whether it's me, whoever it is, another communicator, say, "Man, I felt like that person was speaking directly to me." That's how God's spirit works. Because he got something he's trying to pull out of you, break off of you, prune out of you, strip out of you, mold you, conform you. He wants to bring you to confession or repentance. And the goal is not to say, "Oh, it felt so good to have that revelation today." The goal then is, what am I going to do about it? How am I going to act on what God has called for us to do? In verse 25, James encourages us. He says, "But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty." What's the perfect law? The perfect law of liberty or freedom is the law that Jesus comes to give us. It says, "And perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he'll be blessed in his doing." The perfect law is not a reference back to the Old Testament commandments. It's the reference to the greatest commandment that Jesus gives us, which is that you and I will love the Lord our God with all of our heart, our mind, our soul, our strength, everything that's in us, that God will be first and foremost, and we will live our lives for him. And the second will be like it, that we will love others the way that God has loved us. He says, you build your life on that faith principle. You build your life and all of your relationships Everything in your life is built that God is first and foremost, that you love him with all that you have. You surrender everything you have in your life over to God. You grow in that faith and obedience, and it affects how you interact with God's people. This is how we're called to live our life. How different would marriages be? Parenting be? Relationships be? Our relationship with God would be if we really lived out this principle that Jesus says leads to freedom. Why does it lead to freedom? Because you and I are trying to find life in all of these other things. God is trying to expose to us the areas of life that are shackling us, that are destroying us, that are hurting us and harming us. And we walk out and we don't do anything about it. And he says, I expose that to you because I want you to live a life of freedom. That's what I came to do. If you know the Son of God, then you are set free. Freedom indeed is found in him. How many of us are living free lives today? Let's be honest, this passage is a tough pill to swallow. I don't know what God's calling you to do in response to it, but have you considered in some level that God's calling you to respond in some way today? As I read through this passage, there's so much that I personally feel convicted about. There's so much that I personally need to consider and reconsider about my own life. Again, in my quiet time this week, I just wrote down a few questions. If you want to write some of these down, you can. I think they're questions that we need to answer today, but maybe you need to answer these questions in your own time. This is questions right here. Do my words align with my faith? I say a lot of things, but do the words that I speak actually align with the faith that I say that I have? Am I letting my anger turn into sin? I'll be honest with you, sometimes my anger is not a blessing to God or to anyone else. So when I'm angry, am I allowing my anger and my justification for my anger to turn into sin? What have I done lately in response to my faith? When's the last time that I moved on behalf of what God's been calling me to do? When's the last time I did something? Do I talk more than I act? Do I talk more than I act? Does listening matter if I'm not making time to actually respond? Does listening matter if I don't even really make time to listen? Because a lot of my quiet time is just me talking. Do I make time to listen and to respond? What do I know? What's the truth that I know? What's the faith that I have? And what am I doing about the faith that I say that I have? What has Jesus been calling me to start, to stop, to cut out that I haven't done? Is there any area of my life where I'm being disobedient to God? That's a tough one, right? Because we can justify our disobedience all day long, right? And here's the final question today that I want to ask all of us today that we really have to wrestle with. If there is something that you need to do, why not today? If there's something that God's calling you to do, why not today? Only the enemy will tell you tomorrow, next week. Oh, when I get it all together, when I get it all figured out. If there's something God's calling you to do, why not now? What does God want to do in your life right now? What's he calling you to do in this moment? What's he convicting you of? What's he trying to reveal to you? What's he trying to show to you? What's he trying to peel off? Is there addiction in your life that you keep saying, I'll get to that, I'll get to that? And God's like, let's deal with it today. Is there a sin in your life that you keep running from? And God's like, hey, I'll give you the power today to overcome that sin in your life right now. We can walk through this together. I can give you the strength and power. I don't know what it is. You got somebody in your life that you haven't forgiven. You're holding on to bitterness and resentment. God says bitterness is a pill. You swallow it, it'll set up inside of you, grow a root, and it'll destroy every relationship in your life. Why not today? Begin the process of being healed, set free, walking away from sin, whatever it might be. I don't know what it is today, but we didn't come to just hear something. We came to respond. If I can be honest with you, some of us have been in church longer than I've been alive. We've heard a lot better sermons than what I preach. We've heard a lot of great things. But what have we done with what we've heard? How have we responded? Faith moves us to action. Is faith moving us to do something? Marriage has been hanging by a thread for years and years and years, and you've been doing the same thing over and over and over and over again. You come to places like this, and you feel better about yourself because of what you've heard, but how's it changed your actions? You've lived a defeated life and discouraged over sin, and you've gotten up, and you've told God over and over, I'll walk away, I'll walk away, I'll walk away, but you haven't walked away because you've been trying to do it in your own strength and power. And so what is it today that God is pulling you towards, pulling out of you? And he's saying today, right now in this moment, we're not gonna just be hearers of the word, we're gonna be doers of the word. And what is God calling you to do right now? I'm gonna ask you right now just to stand to your feet. I'm gonna ask our prayer team to come forward. They're in blue shirts. And I'm gonna ask right now that you would just begin to pray in this room, that the Holy Spirit or wherever you are today would begin to move, because he desires to move. The Holy Spirit desires to move anytime God's word is opened. There are some of you today who are dancing on the line of God doing a work in your life. And right now is the moment. Some of you need to give your heart and life to Jesus. Some of you need to get honest about where you've been. Some of you need, in just a moment, as we kind of close out this service together through worship, some of you need to step out and grab somebody and just have somebody pray with you. For your marriage, your life, a struggle, an addiction, a sin, give your life to Jesus. Whatever it is, why not today? Why not right now? This is your opportunity. I don't know what tomorrow holds. I'm not one of these people who are gonna scare you into saying, hey, you might not be here tomorrow, but hey, you might not be here tomorrow. You might not be here next week. The enemy wants you to believe there's always time. I'll get to it, I'll get to it. And you're prolonging what God wants to do in your life right now. There is freedom in this moment right now, if you'll just step into it. I wanna pray for you. I wanna pray that some of you today, that you would respond right now to the Holy Spirit, that he would not let go of you. Even if you are paralyzed in your seat and you have to stay afterwards as everybody else leaves so somebody can come find and pray with you, I just pray that you won't be able to move until you respond to what God's calling.